Welcome back, everyone. Well, as many of you know, for the last 2 weeks especially, we've been covering a lot of stories related to economic development. And one of the issues that has come up, and the mayor has made a priority, is to really tackle the issue of affordable housing in Saratoga. So first, welcome, Mayor. Real nice to have you here, as always.
Thank you.
It came up in the State of the City address, and of course, this past week with the celebration of Martin Luther King Day and whatever, the subject seems to be coming up more and more. Why are you focusing on it and making it a priority?
Because it's a problem, and I hear about it every day, that we're outpricing ourselves right out of our own city. And I want people to think not that affordable housing is a negative term. Affordable housing is a term. And the federal government has certain guidelines to meet that need, but we very rarely do that here in Saratoga Springs, actually meet it to be subsidized by the federal government. Developers have that option. Instead, what I think we need to do as part of the government responsibility is work with the private developers and also the nonprofit organizations to come up with ways to create more price points. So that's what I want people to think about, is to be affordable is to accommodate our own. It's not like we're importing other people to create a lower market price. What we're doing is saying we are a thriving economic community. We depend on tourism. We depend on hospitality. The more restaurants and hotels that are being built, which they are, the more workers we have to accommodate, and we want them to experience the quality of life that we enjoy as well. So, or several generational families that have been here for so long and are having trouble now staying here because they can't afford it anymore. That's a problem, and we need to address it to be a thriving community in the future.
Well, you know what? It's a real catch-22. Saratoga is so unique in the way it's grown over the years. I mean, anybody that's lived here for a while, I mean, we just can't believe the growth in the city. But then again, there's that catch-22. And you make two very important points. You know, this isn't a housing authority, for instance. This is really saying to people, if you would like to work in Saratoga, you can live in Saratoga. And there are plenty of opportunities for people who have careers who want to be in Saratoga. In hospitality, it could be any number of these categories that you listed. But
absolutely.
You know, the other one also is that I talk to people who have lived in this town for generations and now are finding it difficult to maintain the standard of living that they're looking for or that they were used to growing up in these neighborhoods to stay in Saratoga.
So most of the economics can survive on supply and demand, but are times when the government, nonprofit organizations, philanthropic developers will come forward and get together, and that's exactly what I intend to do in 2016, and come up with a plan on how we can create a more variety of price points for housing here. It's people like you and me. I bought my house 25 years ago. I could never afford to buy that house today. So what are we supposed to do when we want to live in Saratoga Springs and work here? So it's not just housing, though. It's apartments. It's micro houses. It's looking at additional units that can be built in already existing locations for the lower price points. But it's really the middle class people, the workforce, that we need to accommodate.
Oh, I think that's so smart. Now, I think it was maybe the end of 2014, right, when you set up the Saratoga Springs Housing Task Force.
Yes.
I think, if my memory serves me, that you started that really with Cheryl Perez because you wanted to really tackle the homeless issue for the veterans. You made good on that promise within that year's time frame, and that task force now, I think, has been sort of redirected, right? Didn't you tell me that?
Correct. So the way I have set up task force or committees or boards or whatever they're called is because enough people come to me and voice a need, an opinion, a willingness to work on a specific issue, and I see commonalities between those folks.
Yeah, got it.
So the housing task force came together because everyone around that table that I appointed brings housing stock to the table. The director, the new director of the housing authority, the public housing, is on the task force. In fact, he's vice chair, Paul Feldman. Cheryl Haig Perez is executive director of RPC,
That's
housing.
Right.
completely manages all the Allen Drive houses. Mm-hmm. And we're looking at land over there that maybe we can get some state funding for to build additional units. Mm-hmm. So everybody is brainstorming about how to increase the inventory and how to create this more variety, as I said, on the spectrum.
Yeah, got it. You know, I want to cycle back on one thing we got before we go. A big craze in Europe are these micro houses. These are homes that are built on a 400 square foot floor plan, and so uniquely designed in whatever. What an interesting solution, right?
And colorful, usually.
Yeah, that's right.
We're looking at that. In fact, there's a whole bunch of people in the city right now that are very interested in this and are looking at different cities in our own country that are doing it. This is something called the continuum of care, in my opinion.
Right.
We heard the governor talk about it at the State of the State. The continuum of care is something that I am working very closely with all the nonprofit agencies on. Because let's say you've got somebody who's down on their luck, they end up at Code Blue one night, and they start talking to staff and personnel and volunteers that really show them the way, and they end up at the shelters of Saratoga, say. They start changing their lives. They start training for a job. They start making money. They need a place to live, but they can't afford a $700,000 condo.
Right.
And we have very few sort of middle to what's the next step there. We have this gap that we need to fill. And so, you know, we're going to do our best to try to attempt to give folks
maybe
less expensive,
right?
Yeah, an opportunity to live here and work here, and that is really what the research shows that hospitality communities and tourism communities work best under.
Well, you know, any thriving community, by the way, depends so much on the quality of life, and that quality of life crosses a lot of income levels and a lot of age groups and a lot of ethnic groups. You know, and that's you know, the city is to continue to grow. It's just wonderful that you're concentrating on the fact that that means everybody, you know. By the way, before we go, on Fridays, and I can't figure out this schedule, so sometimes it's
either.
In the morning, sometimes it's in the afternoons, but usually it's on the week that you do the city council meetings. It's open house at City Hall. No appointment necessary. You got something on your mind, wander into...
Well, I would say the mayor's office. I'm not sure what the
other council members
do. I don't want to put them in a position, but yes, I do open office hours regularly, so no appointment needed. You go on a line. I put my schedule online when I first became mayor, so it's all transparent. It's all, if you don't know when open office hours, just call my assistant, Gail. She'll give you the next one. And I encourage everyone to come in. Some of the best ideas that I've pursued are because someone came in during open office hours and gave me the contact or another idea that we could together work on.
Sure, yeah, got it. Hey, one thing I would ask you, if you could just ask that division that takes care of speeding tickets, if they could be open anytime so I can get in there maybe. Thank you, Mayor, for coming in. Great to see you. Happy cabin fever. We'll get through this.
Happy winter to you.
Good. To see this interview again, you can head to our website, looktvonline.com.